My pleasure to make a short presentation, an overview of a petit man's for anaerobic digestion. So the program will be quite simple with a first introduction where we'll remind the principle of anaerobic digestion and the interest of petit man's. I will discuss about the state of the art of the petit man's of the main feedstocks for anaerobic digestion. So first, the four steps of the biological process for anaerobic digestion. The first one is hydrolysis, which converts polymers into monomers, such as sugars, amino acids, and peptides from polysaccharides and proteins. Then these monomers are converted into organic acids and alcohol via acidogenesis. And through acetogenesis, these compounds are converted into hydrogen and CO2 or acetate. And finally, thanks to methanogenesis, both acetate and the mixture of hydrogen and CO2 are converted into methane and CO2. This is the biogas. So if you deal with wastewater, so soluble organic matter or readily biodegradable organic matter, the rate limiting step will be methanogenesis. So, and you have a risk of accumulations of organic acids or and alcohol, but the problem is organic acid or volatile fatty acid, VFA, which make a risk of decreasing the pH. So you should be careful not to overload your reactor in relation to the capacity of the methanogenesis. But in the case of solid residues, the rate limiting step will be hydrolysis, and it may be facilitated by some pretreatments. So why should we apply a pretreatment before anaerobic digestion? First, maybe to make possible waste feeding into the digester. If you have too big substrate, you will have to grind them to be able to introduce them in the digester. Also, if biodegradable compounds are hardly accessible to microorganisms, it is the case for intracellular compounds of stewage sludge or microalgae, carbohydrates from lignocellulosic biomass, and also for fatty residues. You may also apply some pretreatments for easily biodegradable waste, such as food waste. But in this case, the aim will be to avoid acidification of the digester and also to preserve the biodegradable organic matter. Pretreatments may also allow waste sanitation, the transformation of refractory compounds, and also the removal of inhibitors. It may be the case of ammonia from manure. And finally, you can use a pretreatment to concentrate waste with low methane potential. So what are the consequences of the pretreatments? First, and that's why usually you want to apply pretreatments, is to increase the methane potential, I will call it BMP, or the methane yield. It is the amount of methane that is produced per unit of either total solids or volatile solids. The pretreatments may also increase the anaerobic digestion rate, so you will be able to decrease the hydraulic retention time in the digester. Thanks to pretreatments, you can decrease the viscosity of the feedstock or the digester, so you will be able to increase the TS content in the digester and also the organic loading rate. But some negative impacts may be the loss of biodegradable compounds, the release of refractory or inhibiting compounds, and also they have for sure additional cost. Another consequence of the pretreatment is often the increase of the yield of removal of organic matter. And so the organic matter content will decrease in the digest state. So this may be either an advantage or a disadvantage. It depends what you want to do with the digested. It may be the disadvantage when you want to use the digest state for a land application. So now let's go to see the main substrate applied for in anaerobic digestion. And the first one, stewate sludge, which is the most studied one. So in this game, you can see the quite simple of wastewater treatment plant. First, wastewater go through a primary settling, so primary sludge are produced. Then wastewater go into the activated sludge tank, and after to a settler to recover treated wastewater, and the sludge are either recycled into the aerobic tank, or they are removed and they are waste activated sludge. And you can put into the digester the mixture of primary and waste activated sludge. So the aim of applying a pretreatment of anaerobic digestion will be to reduce the amount of sludge to be disposed and for the cost of the disposal, and secondly, to increase the biogas production. And you have to take in mind, to keep in mind, that primary sludge is more biodegradable than waste-activated sludge, so it will be more beneficial to apply the pretreatment to the waste-activated sludge than the primary one. So the limitation for sludge anaerobic digestion is the low accessibility of intracellular compounds. So the pretreatment first objective will be the microbial cell lysis in order to release intracellular compounds. You may also lead to flock destructuration in order to solubilize exopolymeric substance. There are several full-scale process that you can find in the wastewater treatment plants. The main ones are thermal hydrolysis and ultrasounds. We'll discuss them later. But there are also some processes based on high pressure up to several hundred bars with or not soda addition, and also with more moderate pressure, about a few dozen bars. There are also some techniques based on pulse electric field, leasing centrifugation, and you can add some enzyme into the digester. So considering sonication, usually low frequency processes are used, about 20 kilohertz, in order to promote mechanical impacts. If you use the higher frequencies, some chemical processes with oxidation will be favored. At full scale, applied energy is about 5 kilowatt-hour per cubic meter of sludge. And it is interesting to notice that most of the laboratory studies use quite higher applied energy. And usually the sonication is applied only to a fraction of the sludge flow. The consequences are then first an increase of anaerobic digestion rate, and also an increase of the yields of sludge removal and biogas production. I put a question mark after dewaterability, because according to the conditions, dewaterability may be enhanced or decreased. Sonication allows also the reduction of foaming in the digester. I have put several commercial devices of sonication, but also I forgot to tell that most of them are continuous one with a flow of sludge going into such devices. For thermal hydrolysis, most common conditions are a temperature ranging from 150 to 170 degrees under a few bars, and for duration about 30 minutes. system can be equipped with a flash system or not. That means that they have a system to allow a sudden pressure release, and they can be batch or continuous. Again, the consequence will be the improvement of anaerobic digestion rate and also of the sludge removal and biogas production release. Yeah, the dewaterability for such temperature is highly enhanced, and also the viscosity is reduced. Another advantage is the sludge is in relation, and in USA they can speak of CASA byproducts. Yeah, some picture of the main processes can be is the most popular one. Yeah, with its application in Bruxelles, in Belgium. And from Veolia, a French company, we have both a batch system, Biotelis, and a continuous one, Excelis. Cambi is equipped with a flash system. Now, what about animal byproducts or fatty waste? The limitation of anaerobic digestion is the they allow solubility in aqueous phase. They float on the digester surface and they can also make some foaming in the digester. So the pretreatment objectives will be the increase of the contact between the waste and microorganism and the waste solubilization. Also, we'll see that sanitation is required at least by European legislation. So this legislation requires size reduction and the thermal treatment either of at 70 degrees for 1 hour or 133 degrees for 20 minutes under at least 3 bars. And you have here a commercial process from host which fit to these requirements. You can also use some pretreatments, mainly enzymatic hydrolysis with, of course, lipase. And saponification is interesting because it allows the fatty waste solubilization, so you can increase the lipid loading rate of the digester. So to carry out sort of saponification, you need an alkali to get a pH higher than 9, and you carry it out either at 70 degrees at quite high temperature in order to fit with the legislation or higher temperature. Now about the food waste and organic fraction of municipal solid waste. So the limitation concerning the anaerobic digestion will be the loss of readily biodegradable matter during the storage and the risk of acidification. And in a lesser extent, the low accessibility of some compounds. So in consequence, the pretreatment objectives will be to preserve methane potential, to mitigate the VFR production, and also it can be interesting to facilitate the sorting of the municipal solid waste and the increase of the accessibility of some biodegradable compounds. And we will be treated in the lignocellulosic biomass section. So first, to preserve the methane potential, some authors from Greece have proposed a system to dry food waste, a home drying of food waste. They also commercially available some anaerobic storings, and some of them combine grinding, compacting, and at the end they store in an airproof tank. I have put here a picture of a biotank from the startup in France, but also they are system which are commercially available and produced by industry which propose equipment for kitchens. So you can also tested some aerobic pretreatment to mitigate the VFR say production in the digester, but a disadvantage led was a big loss of organic matter during the pretreatment. And also you see again the picture I show you in the sludge section. The same process can be a thermal hydrolysis is used for municipal solid waste. And one of the main advantages is it facilitates the waste sorting. It also leads to some organic matter solubilization, so it's anaerobic digestion, and to the reduction of the viscosity. Yes, what about manure? Yeah. The anaerobic digestion limitation is, for some of them, the high nitrogen concentration. It's the case of culture manure. And also the low accessibility of some compounds, mainly nitrocellulosic biomass with straw. And also they present a low biogas potential, which is when it's reported to the volume because of the high concentration in water. So the pretreatment objectives will be to reduce the nitrogen compound, to increase the accessibility of biodegradable compounds, and in one case, we see to increase the temperature of the waste and concentrate the organic matter in the waste. So you first, at a full scale, you will have several types of grinding processes. You can also have some anaerobic pre-hydrolysis, so it's more or less the same as a two-stage anaerobic digestion process. And you have here the example of the boost process from the Evalor company in France. You can also use thermo-alkaline pretreatment, which combine both the ammonia stripping and the solubilization of hardly accessible compounds. And this is quite interesting for poultry manure. It's the NIX process. In the case of the batch anaerobic digestion, and mainly batch high solid anaerobic digestion, you can use some aerobic pretreatment to increase the temperature of the feedstock. So you can reduce the heating requirement of the batch system, and also you speed up the startup. And finally, you may use a microbial or fungal consortia to improve this aerobic step. And some of them may be used spread in the animal bedding just before recovering the manure. Finally, you can see some examples of the pig manure concentration by centrifugation in order to reduce the digester volume. Now let's skip to lignocellulosic biomass. In this case, the limitation is the low accessibility of carbohydrates, which are embedded in the lignocellulosic matrix. So the pretreatment objectives will be the solubilization or alteration of the structure of lignin, the breakdown of lignin to carbohydrate bonds, the increase of specific area, either also the reduction of cellulose crystallinity, the solubilization of cellulose and hemicellulose, and finally, you may also use pretreatment to make possible the feeding of the substrate into the digester. So there are several processes which are commercially available, first with different techniques of grinding, other processes with combined grinding and mixing. We have some electrokinetic disintegration, extrusion, sonication, and also enzyme addition. At lab scale, research studies are mainly based on pretreatments which have been developed for second generation bioethanol. And maybe we'll see just now alkaline pretreatment and biological pretreatment with wet root fungi. So if you compare now the impact of the pretreatments on bioethanol production or for anaerobic digestion, we will see some few differences. First, for bioethanol, the objective of pretreatments will be lignin solubilization and structure alteration, the surface area increase, hemicellulose solubilization, and the decrease in crystallinity. But usually, you don't want to solubilize cellulose, and the release of inhibitors such as furfural or hydroxymethylfurfural should also be avoided. Now, if we look at the impact of such effects on the methane potential, again, lignin impact on lignin will be highly beneficial. The surface increase is beneficial, but I think it's less important than for bioethanol. The same for cellulose solubilization and crystallinity decrease. But now the cellulose solubilization is no longer a problem. And also, if the concentration is remains low, the furfural and hydroxymethyl furfural can be converted into biogas. So they are no longer a problem. There may be some different points if we look at the anaerobic digestion rate, with quite beneficial and high impacts of all the parameters here, and a negative impact of the release of the inhibitors of bioethanol production. And now, if you look at how can we achieve lignin solubilization, first, you see that some pretreatments with ammonia, oxidation, thermoalkaline pretreatments, and also fungi will be efficient. The same ones will lead to lignin alteration, and also thermal acid and steam explosion also can alter this lignin. The crystallinity is reduced mainly by ammonia pretreatments and a little by oxidation and grinding. Hemicellulose solubilization is quite easy to achieve, and it's quite high in the case of thermal and acid pretreatments. For cellulose solubilization, you need thermal acid pretreatment, and also it may achieve by some kinds of grinding. And more or less all the pretreatment leads to the increase of specific surface. Concerning byproducts, furanic compounds are released by thermal and acid pretreatments, whereas phenolic compounds, they originate from lignin degradation, so they are rather released by thermoalkaline ones. So, and as you remember, I told you that lignin solubilization and lignin alteration will be the most important in effect for the pretreatment for anaerobic digestion. So I will more speak about thermal alkaline and fungi pretreatment. First, for concerning whitewood fungi, in the study, we compared several strains of whitewood fungi to pretreat wet straw. And you can see here that if we measure the methane potential of pretreated straw, you have a higher biodegradability thanks to all the strains. And up, we had an improvement to 33% in comparison to the control wet straw. But we observe some mass losses during the pretreatment, and they range from 40 to up to 30% of total solids. So if you express your methane potential towards the initial total solids, you can see here that's quite lower effectiveness with several methane yield lower than the control, and with only one strains which were interesting with 21% increase in methane potential. Another study used the same strain to apply to different substrates, and they found, for example, in the case of azale branches, a quite interesting increase, 100 increase of BMP. But in contrast, in the case of acacia branches, they observe no BMP variation, and the decrease of the BMP in the case of sugarcane bagasse or barley straw. So as a kind of small conclusion, the fungi pretreatment results depend on the fungal stand and also on the substrate. But a quite significant disadvantage is the need of sterilization step, which is very difficultly, hardly shareable in an anaerobic digestion plant. Now let's see some thermochemical treatments. So yeah, in, we compare different processes on the sunflower stalks. And you can see here that only thermal at 55 degrees was not very interesting comparing to the untreated substrate. At 100 degrees, we had a higher increase, and both alkaline and acid and also oxidation led to quite significant increase. But we had the highest result, the highest improvement with the soda pretreatments. So we applied this pretreatment with four gram soda per gram of TS. It's 4 gram soda per 100 gram of TS, sorry, for 24 hours, 55 degrees. And we tested anaerobic digestion on semi-continuous reactor, where they were mesophilic one, with a hydraulic retention time of 21 days and the organic loading rate of 1.49 gram VS per liter and per day. And after stabilization, we observe a 26% improvement in biogas production. So if we assume that biogas is used by cogeneration with a yield of 35% power and 50% heat, you still will have a 26% improve in power, but concerning heat, you need to calculate energy balance as you consume heat to carry out the pretreatment. So you can see on this graph the additional heat production after pretreatment minus the requirement of heat for the pretreatments. And in the conditions where the experiment at lab scale were carried out, you can see that we had a negative energy balance. This can be improved if we assume that heat can be 80% of heat can be recovered. Or also, you may achieve a positive energy balance by carrying out the pretreatment ITS content. And of course, combining ITS content and heat recovery will improve again the energy balance. We also carried out alkaline pretreatment, prior ice solid batch anaerobic digestion. And for that, we used some sorghum, and the pretreatment was carried out at 130 grams total solid per kilogram. You can see in the picture, there's some water, but no visible water. We use soda or lime at the dose of 10% at room temperature, and for 1 day for the soda or 5 days for the lime, because it is quite less efficient. So after that, we co-digested the sorghum with cattle manure with a dose of 15% sorghum in weight basis or 39% in VS basis. And this was carried out in isolated leach bed batch reactor. Here are the results. So in green, you have raw sorghum with no pigments. In red, the pigment with lime, and in blue, the soda pigment. In all cases, we observe an increase in the anaerobic digestion rate, and at the end, the methane production was higher after soda pigment. But we should be careful if the digestate will be used for land application. So soda may not be recommended in order not to increase the salt concentration in the soils. So now in another study, we compare alkaline pretreatment and for co-digestion. And it was applied in the case of waste activated sludge, olive pomace, and macroalgae residue after agar extraction. So then we study the impact of potash pretreatment on the methane yield and also on the digestate quality, which was assessed by some tomato plant growth. So first about, the condition of the pretreatment, it was 5% potash, 2 days at room temperature, and the anaerobic digestion was mesophilic with 20 days retention time and 1 gram VS per liter and per day. About methane production, we can see that the methane yield could be increased either by co-digestion, thanks to the both co-substrate comparing to the sludge alone, or by the potash pretreatment with at a maximum increase of almost 50%. Now, if we look at the amount of the biomass yield in gram of total solid per 100 grams, 100 plants, so you can see an increase of the biomass yield after all the digestate application in comparison to the soil without any fertilization, and also equivalent biomass yield in comparison to the industrial mineral fertilizer. Tomato yield were correlated to the content of phosphorus, total nitrogen, and ammonia in the digestate. Phosphorus was bring by the sludge, and the alkaline pretreatment led to an increase in the ammonia content because of higher degradation of the proteins. Well, just a small conclusion about the alkaline pretreatment, which are very extensively studied at lab scale, but they're not implemented yet at full scale. So maybe to favor the implementation, we should promote low input conditions. It should be room temperature, so they will last 1 or few days, low water content, no mixing, and using lime or potash rather than soda if digestate is applied to soils. You can also apply treatment, now we will call it post-treatment, on the digestate and introduce again the digestate into the digester. Yeah, we applied either soda or lime pretreatments to several digestate, and we could reach up to more than 40% increase in the BMP compared to the digestate itself. You can see also that again, and unfortunately, soda is more efficient than lime. And so as a small conclusion, the methane production can be increased by the alkali pretreatment, but they also bring cost and further environmental impact. And in this case, we showed the interest of direct recirculation of the digestate without any pretreatment. You can see here one process, which is called ruminator from host, which consists in grinding the digest date and recirculation into the digester. Well, that's more or less the last samples I took from the literature, some examples of the pretreatment allowed to use a substrate, but no one would have thought to put them in the digester. First, bamboo chips with a very low methane potential, less than 5 milliliters per gram of TS, and that they were very significantly improved after a steam explosion process. The chicken feathers, after some enzymatic pretreatments with alkaline endopeptides, the methane potential was significantly increased, and they showed stable codigestion in the continuous reactor. To finish, I would like to compare the impact of the pretreatments in BMP tests and CSTR reactors. First, I show you some of the results with sunflower stalks. In the BMP, we achieved a 33% increase, and in the CSTR with 21 days retention time, it was only 26%. In the contrary, for sorghum, the increase in CSTR was higher in BMP. And in addition, thanks to the pretreatment, we had some more stable reactors thanks to the high alkalinity. So do not use the BMP results to predict the full-scale CSTR performance of the pretreatments. So it's time to conclude. So I would say to each feedstock, its pretreatments. And in the case of codigestion, you may use one pretreatment for each kind of substrate, or if it is not possible, the pretreatment should be, of course, applied to the most recalcitrant one. Pretreatments, so we have seen they're efficient to increase the anaerobic digestion rate and methane production. So they can make some feedstock interesting for anaerobic digestion, but they can also be useless in some cases. And the impact of a pretreatment depends on the anaerobic digestion conditions. It will be not the same if it is in BMP tests or in actual conditions, in batch or in continuous system. And in the continuous system, the hydraulic retention time will be important. Thanks to the increase of the anaerobic digestion rate, the lower retention time, the higher impact of the pretreatment. And finally, pretreatment should be economically viable and have low environmental impact. So in the case of cogeneration, you should favor the use of heat produced by biogas. You should work with ITS content, heat recovery, and so on. Well, I thank you for your attention, and I will be pleased to answer your question.